Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Trapped by Nick Louth, narrated by Alister Austin and Lana Wallace-Taylor. The dead don't die, they look on and help. D.H. Lawrence. Chapter 1. This is my wife, Catherine, yesterday evening. Tuesday. You can see her with a screwdriver in the boot of our Nissan, trying to tighten the screws on the anchor points for the new child seat. I tell her that they are secure. The man at the shop who installed it told us so, and he is fully qualified. I'd already double-checked the seat too, watched the video, read the instructions, used all my strength to test the straps, wobbled it, tried to pull it loose. It was fine, but for her that wasn't enough. When it comes to Ethan, nothing is ever enough. She fears that in a collision our one-year-old son could be catapulted from the back seat through the windscreen. Since Ethan arrived, Catherine has developed a tendency to worry about all sorts of things. Sometimes it is reasonable, sometimes not. She is understandably anxious about the odd-shaped mole on her right shoulder. She frets about her figure and the smile line she has acquired at 41, and seems to be convinced that one day I will no longer find her attractive. She's wrong. I will adore her to my dying day, I can guarantee that now. I love her corkscrew copper hair and her pale freckled skin, even though she hates it and wishes she were a dark-haired, olive-skinned Italian. Wishing you were something else, someone else, somewhere else. It's so clear to me now that you have what you have and you make of it what you can. That's what matters, when the time comes when you are tested. You never know when that will be. I didn't know, and neither here does she, still working on that seat for our son. Look at her. She has no idea of what is going to happen in less than 24 hours. That would make her worry, no mistake. That mole, Catherine survived skin cancer, you see. She knew about the risks. She never sunbathed, was rarely drawn to the beach, always wore a broad-brimmed hat and gallons of sunscreen when on our brief foreign holidays. She had been aware since childhood that with her milky skin and about as many freckles as a galaxy has stars, that there would always be a chance of some malevolent sun-seared alien cell splitting and growing in a forgotten corner of her epidermis, and she had always looked out for the arrival of that malignity. Believe me, she looked. I saw her after every shower in front of the mirror. But it was a dab of pigment she noticed for the first time under the nail of a left little toe, just a smear of brown visible through the cuticle when she was about to apply nail varnish. It didn't even look like the moles you see on the chart, but better safe than sorry. The nail was removed, the offending clump of melanocytes excised and tested. The test results were not good. Acral lentiginous melanoma, not benign, malignant, dangerous, potentially lethal, that tiny little blot. It's not related to sun exposure, so there was no blame on her or us. Still, tests showed that it had spread to a lymph node on the foot. A sentinel node, that's what they call them, watching out for trouble. If that's infected, then the next stage is worse. Stage 3, they call it, like some tricky examination. Maths, further maths, much further maths. Catherine had her entire lymph node basin removed from her foot and ankle. Basin. It's a good description for what is an entire river system, carrying white blood cells to where they are needed and taking toxins away. But hiding away amongst the toxins are cancerous cells still alive. She was 38, and she was very brave about it. When under local anaesthetic, she watched them peel back her creamy skin, remove the nodes, then stitch it almost invisibly back. The next node, the next basin, seemed to be uninfected. It was then a question of waiting, cancer's Russian roulette. That was when the question of having a child became more urgent. As she always said to me, that's what I was made for, to bring a new life into the world. and to protect it, Catherine, against all the badness this world can throw at you. That's why you survived cancer, Catherine. You have a job to do. I can't help you now. No one can help you. It's your task alone. I know the date and the time and the place, but I can't come back and warn you. God, how I wish that I could. Tuesday, almost 8 in the morning, and she has to leave for work in half an hour. I've just finished getting Ethan up. Catherine is doing Pilates, lying in the centre of the lounge, listening to the CD, whose soft rainforest music is full of bird calls and pattering raindrops. Because of the time, she hasn't bothered to put her leggings and leotard on. She's just wearing shorts and an old T-shirt with a faint orange stain on one side that, I am now experienced enough to be sure, is baby vomit. The voice on the CD, all mid-Atlantic vowels and breathy enthusiasm, is enjoining her to be aware of her own body, its balance and alignment. Make sure you are square aware, and breathe. Breathe in until you have expanded your ribcage to its maximum. Now hold it gently and make a few slow pelvic tilts. Mindfulness seems out of reach, though. She eyes me, staring at her, and starts giggling. Don't! You know I can't concentrate if you watch. More giggling, but I stay leaning in the doorway, my arms folded, a slight grin on my face as I listen to Ethan's happy burbling from the bedroom. Her hips tilt, her tummy flattens, the puke patch creases. I see the telltale vibration in her diaphragm, silent laughter. Right, that's it! She jumps up and chases me around the lounge. I let her catch me by the kitchen door and she tickles me quite hard in the ribs. As I mock up a wounded expression, she stands on tiptoes to give me a slow, languorous kiss. Tonight, I promise, he'll sleep better even if I have to have a G&T before I feed him. She whispers, "You are going to drug our precious child," I say in faux horror. She smiles and licks my neck. It's a delicious feeling. Maybe. I did get that promised act of lovemaking on Tuesday night. It was wonderful. It was my last. Chapter 2. Wednesday. There are poignant moments from the start of that terrible day. It's 8:30. I've just come down from the bathroom and I see there has been something of a breakfast incident. Catherine is in the kitchen holding the remains of a pot of yoghurt. She's bending over, sweetly dishevelled and looking meaningfully at Ethan in his high chair. There is yoghurt all around Ethan's mouth, on the plastic tray and speckled on the floor. Catherine puts her little finger in a yoghurt smear on his tray and paints the goop around her own mouth. Ethan explodes in chuckles and repeatedly bangs his plastic teaspoon on the tray in appreciation of this mimicry. "Messy mummy," Catherine says before putting the finger in her mouth. Fair trade, sugar-free tropical fruit flavour. All the milk from certified happy cows. Do you want some, Ethan? Ethan bangs his spoon again, spattering yoghurt liberally. He loses his grip on the upstroke. The spoon sails over his shoulder and a vanilla blob lands in Catherine's hair. We all laugh. I wish I had a camera. But never mind. I'll remember it forever. Good memories are an insulation. They help cushion the blows of life. Even of death. Later on Wednesday, but still in Manchester, same city, different world. Maybe 2 miles from where we live, a young man stirs to a not very new day in a basement flat that reeks of socks, booze, fags and weed. It's 11 o'clock. He's wreathed in grey sheets that haven't been washed since God knows when. His shaven head is half under a pillow, a twisted mouth snoring. More visible is a protruding shoulder, a muscled hillock of indigo and viridian, entwined foliage around a dagger, blade upwards and the initials tattooed beneath in Gothic script, MSM on his pale, freckled skin. The floor is strewn with clothes. There are cans too, Carling, Red Bull, Bulmers, Coke. He's not fussy, so long as it supplies the effects he's looking for. Look around and you see crisp packets, biscuit wrappers, a half-eaten pizza slice, a KFC box. In a heap by a huge TV, boxes for video games. Carmageddon, Dark Souls 3, Dead Rising. But don't get me wrong, this is not a drug den. There isn't a single crystal of crack cocaine in the place, nor a syringe. Liam generally gets his buzz and his stupefaction, his energy intake and his entertainment, from familiar sources. In that respect, he's like the rest of us, only more so. I'd slid back a few days to take a closer look at him and how he lived, given how we were going to get to know him, Catherine, Ethan and I. The animal purity and immediacy of his impulses are almost beautiful. He's a single-minded jaguar for the urban jungle. Thirsty, get a can. Hungry, go to KFC or Mickey D's. Tired, get a Red Bull. Bored, slay some zombies. Angry? Yeah, every day there was anger. Well, the outlets for that were legion, usually indulged fraternally with the rest of the nocturnal tribe. Liam Fretwell is a gang criminal, of course, and the flat belongs to the gang. For a supposedly successful con, there's only one thing missing, and that's money. He has just 15 quid in his jeans pocket, a few coins on the floor. He's on the run from prison, but that doesn't worry him. What does bother him is that he's skint, and he hates being skint. It's a personal affront to his standing, his status and prestige. He knows who to blame. Spark or Sinclair. Today's the day when that score gets settled. His eyes are opening. They are startling icy blue, set in a skin almost as pale as Catherine's. He has a malevolent pucker between his dark eyebrows and a short but deep scar along the side of his nose from a Stanley knife wound. That was from his first landing altercation at HMP Wakefield 7 years ago when he was 19. It looks nasty, but as he would always say, you should have seen the other guy. I want to understand Liam Fretwell. He was a one-year-old once, probably a yoghurt thrower, I don't know. Probably chucked stones too a little later, I can't go back that far or get that level of detail. But I know this, something clicked early in that cascading interconnection of genetics and environment that turned him into a monster. Yet he wasn't one of those offspring who would be easy to predict on that trajectory. He had parents, two of them, both present for his childhood. No abuse on the record, no domestic violence. An older brother, Stephen, who became a joiner and now makes posh kitchens for big houses in Wilmslow. His own business, doing well. But not Liam. Something there inside him, something wrong, something twisted and nasty. A kind of carcinogenic mole of the soul. Neither sought out nor excised. A lump of resentment gone bad. What was initially an indifference to the pain and suffering of others became by late teenage years a little kick of pleasure. A pulse of power. The first flexings of intimidation helped that nodule of badness crystallize into evil. Back to us, on that damp Wednesday in April. The puddles from the last shower are drying on the tarmac. I will get to see a close-up of that tarmac, believe me. Reliving it, I'm now getting tetchy about not being able to warn her. I mean, there was really no reason why it had to be that day that we drove to Manchester Royal Infirmary, on her monthly appointment to see the mole people, as she called them. And those dermatologists do indeed reside underground, in an absurdly overheated linoleum-lined basement that smells of hot dust and disinfectant. If we'd known about the dangers of today, we could have asked for a new appointment. There are always cancellations. The good old NHS will always cheerily put you back in the queue. It's what they do. It's no good me thinking about that now. It happened. The day was set. That Wednesday made sense for Catherine because the computer system at her work was being upgraded. It's always useless for half a day afterwards, and I can't bear to hear Helen whinging about her emails for the rest of the day. She laughed, that lovely, infectious chuckle. I'd just rather be somewhere else, anywhere else. Yes, she certainly ended up somewhere else, and so did I. Life-changing days hide in with the others, like jokers in a pack of cards, imposters in the weekly roll call of trivia and tedium. We were preparing for the hated Asda run to Hume, a necessary chore on the way back from the mole people. I'd just paid the council tax, Catherine had rung her mother. The babysitter had let us down, so Ethan had to come with us. Then there were bags for life, batteries to recycle, a long once-a-month list of stuff you can't get at Aldi. I mean, we're only talking tin prunes and coconut milk, bales of cheap toilet roll, that kind of thing. But there was the Moss Side Deli to visit too. Well, that's what we called it. It had some Asian name with initials, KG Stores, I think, on Claremont Road. It was the highlight of any food shopping trip for me, not that there was much competition. But the Moss Side Deli supplies wonders that we can't get anywhere else locally. Ready-made dolmatas with vine leaves, fresh okra for ladyfinger curry or for Cajun cuisine, sweet potato, fresh curry leaves, soft Kurdish cheese in huge tins. That is all my department. I'm the house husband. Travel the world in 80 tastes. I love to cook for her. Well, I did. Can't anymore, of course. But that's why we are where we are, parked on Walton Road just round the corner from KG Stores in the middle of Moss Side at 4:03 p.m. on Wednesday, the 12th of April. Caught up in the biggest spree killing in Manchester's history. I am in the shop, you see, when it happens, immersed in the smell of spices, the heady garam masala, the sweet cakey dust of cinnamon, the tang of cumin, a little bit of the exotic yeast. So I don't see what happens outside at the time. I know now, of course, I know everything now. That comes of being where I am now. That knowledge is a kind of privilege, but it's frustrating too. To be able to watch over her, but not to hold her hand, not to kiss her. To know what she's thinking, but not to be able to let her know what I'm thinking. Not to be able to tell her that I love her. Not to be able to comfort. That hurts, honestly, it does. Because there is so much to tell her, now I know it all. The first I know is the sound of a car revving. I glance up and out into the street. The beige Nissan, our little Nissan, with missing front left hubcap. On the far side, a bulky man-shape that I would later know to be Liam Fretwell is in the driving seat. My seat. And a tall, skinny Afro-Caribbean man has the front passenger door open. A blink of an eye and he's in. Our car. My little boy, 1 year old in a week's time, would be in his little car seat. And where is Catherine? All this I take in instantly. I drop everything and just sprint. I have a clear run through the shop doorway. I'm bellowing Catherine's name and everyone just shrinks back to let me pass. I'm not beefy, I'm not threatening, but I am tall. 6'4", anger looks odd on me like a furious giraffe. The Nissan is pulling a U-turn, tires screeching, which gives me 2 seconds to decide what to do before it passes back in front of me towards Princess Road. I can make Catherine out. I can see she is in the back by the corona of golden sunlight around her hair, and I can see her protective arm around the child seat. Her stance instantly telegraphs that Ethan is in it, even though he's too low for me to see. The front passenger has turned round towards her, an arm outstretched, rigid, and I can see the driver now on my side, his merciless taut face and his thick, tattooed arms. He stares at me and seems to know what I am already committed to doing. The only meaningful option. I sprint out into the road, heedless of the traffic, and throw myself headlong onto the bonnet of our car. The bang as I hit the windscreen puts me face to face with them both for the first time. Fretwell and cousins. On the day in question, Liam Fretwell, 26, an enforcer for the Moss Side Mafia, is busy. He's being sought by the police and on the run from prison, but has already found time for 2 murders. The first was planned, Frankie Sparko Sinclair. Sparko is, no, let me correct myself, was a sad case. The disabled alcoholic and small-time crook who had been Fretwell's former neighbour and drinking partner. To be an associate of Fretwell's was Sparko's last deadly descent on a slow slide of bad luck. A former Royal Signals corporal, he had served in Iraq, but after discharge couldn't cope. Violent outbursts and a conviction for domestic abuse, a broken marriage, periods of drug dependency, alcoholism, some jail time, and occasional homelessness. Several years earlier, in a different life, I had actually been Sinclair's probation officer. Considering he only had one leg and was confined to a wheelchair, he led me a merry dance. But for all that, I don't think he deserved what Fretwell did to him. Nobody deserves that. The biggest surprise about Sparko, I suppose, is that such a fourth division lowlife got himself into such Premier League trouble. Everyone in my district knew about Fretwell. He already had a reputation even at 17 when I was still in the probation service and overheard the conversations. A man to make anyone quiver. 2 years later, he was sentenced to life with a tariff of 14 years for the torture and killing of two members of a rival drug gang and the theft of their loot. It was a significant sum, more than 2 million in various currencies which the RHC 22 gang had snatched from a hold-up at a bureau de change in the Arndale shopping centre and a hoard of amphetamines. None of it was ever recovered. Fretwell was a classic Category A prisoner, violent, disruptive, and incapable of good behaviour. The word recidivism might have been invented for him. There was no way that he was going to be allowed the kind of early release that is available to those prisoners who show signs of remorse and rehabilitation. Fretwell had been determined to escape, but HMP Wakefield is not the easiest of jails to get out of. Only one person has done so in its entire history, and that was in 1959. Still, there are ways. Fretwell collapsed in his cell at 2 a.m. on Sunday morning, screaming for help. He complained of unbearable pains in his abdomen. The prison's duty medic was called and, after examining him and given the location of the pain, feared that Fretwell had peritonitis. He signed off for him to be taken to the nearest accident and emergency department at Pinderfields Hospital, just a couple of miles away. Prison service regulations stipulate that any Category A prisoner should be accompanied by at least 4 prison officers outside the grounds. Given the prison service recruitment crisis, the regulations are, of course, a complete fantasy. That was as many officers as the entire prison had for a weekend night shift. So Fretwell was accompanied in the ambulance by just 2 officers and, despite the protestations of the 2 paramedics, was handcuffed to the gurney on which he lay, writhing in apparent agony. The main entrance to HMP Wakefield is in the city centre, on the inappropriately named Love Lane, an area of old warehouses and industrial estate adjoining the main railway line. At precisely 2:52 a.m. after picking up Fretwell, but before the ambulance had even crossed back into Parliament Street, it was rammed by a stolen car and brought to a halt. As the paramedics emerged to check if the driver was injured, 2 masked men from a 3rd vehicle held them up at gunpoint. One of the assailants tied up the paramedics and put them in the stolen car. The other opened the back of the ambulance. The prison officers were forced to release Fretwell and then tied up too. The prisoner, pausing only to repeatedly stamp on the head of one officer he particularly disliked, was whisked away by his fellow gang members. Fretwell was back in hiding in Manchester in 2 hours. It was without doubt the most precisely organised event that Fretwell had ever been involved in, though the credit, if that is the right word, should not go to him but to the brains at the top of the Moss Side Mafia. Fretwell reckoned Sparko owed him money. A lot of money, and presumably the gang was in for a cut if they helped spring him from jail. Fretwell was at Sparko's address on Walton Road, Moss Side, by 2 o'clock on Monday. He knew it well. He used to live on the first floor until his jailing 7 years ago. Sparko had lived below in the wheelchair-accessible ground floor flat. There was nothing remarkable about it. It was part of a 1960s purpose-built block, 6 flats, 2 on each floor. It was originally council-owned, then sold off to a housing association which struggled to keep on top of the maintenance. It fitted right in with the depressed urban milieu of Mossside. The satellite dishes, the abandoned settee in the front yard of an adjacent house, the scattered wheelie bins, the litter, the row of nearby shops with graffitied roller shutters. Fretwell turned the place over, smashed it up good and proper, but there was no sign of Sparko or the money. Now, about Sparko Sinclair. Put yourself in his position. Fretwell was not a man you would double-cross even when he was inside, given his gangland connections. But if you heard he was out and gunning for you, then it really would be time to hide. Sparko must have been psychic. He must have heard within the day of Fretwell's escape. Maybe it was someone on the inside at Wakefield tipping him the knowledge. Whatever it was, Sparko vanished. Quite an impressive feat for a one-legged man confined to a wheelchair. Fretwell spent the next 24 hours chucking Sparko's name around the streets, bouncing it around the mates, the bruvs and the boys, hoping for a useful echo. Then he got lucky. Janelle Cousins, another of the Mossside crew, supplied the occasional bag of cannabis to the single mum who now occupied Fretwell's old flat. Lorraine Caldwell told Janelle that Sparko had left in a hurry by taxi on Monday evening. She was glad about it because, as she put it, it was a minging pisshead. But she had no idea where he'd gone. All this was just round the corner, three doors down from KG Stores, where next day I would be picking through the Kurdish delicacies for my beloved Catherine. Those delicacies, which would end up in the bin, uncooked, unprepared, forgotten. Three doors and 20 yards separated two worlds. One of delicious, exotic food, the other which would on that fateful Wednesday turn out to be the site of an unprovoked murder by Fretwell and Cousins, their second killing of that day and by no means the last. A busy day for death. Janelle Cousins. Now there's a story. A Jamaican mother, no known father, and a life lived mostly in the urine-stained stairwell of Block B, Palmerston Fields. The one tower where the lights were always broken between floors 10 and 14, and where the lift had never worked for more than a day at a time. A small but significant no-go area on which the council had given up. Janelle, known as Jazza, had two older sisters. Letitia, the first, went to college, left Mossside and never came back. She was the success, the one social workers smiled about. Alicia was younger and went off the rails pretty quickly. Staying out all night, drugs, bad boys. And it was one of those boys who drew Janelle into the world of gangs. His first job was as a runner, delivering, receiving. Then he was to hold a shooter which he kept at the bottom of a box of dirty mags under his bed, ready for the call on the burner phone they had given him. But Jazza Cousins had a weakness for girls. He ended up running the pass-arounds for the Mossside Mafia. The drug-addicted teenagers who were kept available for gang leaders, and the best-looking of whom were offered as tribute when meeting the Albanians, the suppliers of choice. Now, back to the main event. It took until the afternoon of the next day, Wednesday, for Fretwell and Cousins to find out where Sparko had moved to. It was just a few miles away, probably another tip-off on the gangland grapevine, or maybe they tracked down the taxi driver, we'll probably never know. Fretwell did the damage to Sparko that he planned, and quickly, because he knew he had to be. But 5 minutes of torture is still a long time, I think you'd agree. Lit cigarettes, eyelids, testicles. You see what I'm saying? Sparko must have told them what they wanted to hear because they were back at Walton Road in a few minutes. There, they smashed in the skull of Lorraine Caldwell, their informant, in front of her two-year-old daughter, and left her body on the stairs. That's what they thought of motherhood. But then they were hot on the trail of Fretwell's missing money. It was a gory trail, too. By 3:40 p.m, Sparko was dead. By 3:50 p.m, Lorraine Caldwell was dead. 20 minutes later, I'd be joining them. So, how did I get to be there at that moment? It was all decided years earlier. You could say that Catherine had hunted me down. She wrote the spec, she researched the means, scanned the possibilities, checked every detail, locked on and closed in for the kill. I was a project. She told me all about it, though not for years afterwards. The husband project. Planned and executed, perhaps not on time, but certainly within budget. Catherine hadn't had a lot of luck with men. There had been boyfriends, of course. Her figure guaranteed an interest, especially from a distance. Catherine was busty, something I liked from the start, but she hated. For my whole adult life, I've been forced to carry around a billboard which always attracts one kind of man, the last type I'm actually looking for, she once said. That's why she practiced what she called defensive dressing. Trousers rather than skirts, lowish heels, but crucially, two or more colourful ethnic scarves looped loosely over whatever blouse or top she was wearing. Urban camouflage. By the time she met me, she had been dressing defensively for years, and her conclusion was that it led men's eyes back up to her face. As a result, she was listened to, her opinions were more valued, and she was respected. That's not very scientific, of course. I didn't tell her that, because I learned early on never to challenge her most strongly held views. But my own feeling was that self-worth came as much from the inside as the outside. The process of building self-respect and identity. She was constructing the Catherine that she wanted to be. Growing up, you could say. But a lifetime isn't long enough to grow up completely. It's certainly not long enough to be ready for the worst that can happen. Nothing can prepare you for that. Because these things are not meant to be part of your life. Born, childhood, school, college, job, marriage, kids, and retirement. Where does violent abduction fit in that list? It doesn't. It belongs to someone else's life. Someone like Fretwell's. Only there's a snag. Fretwell's life has collided with ours. Mayhem has smashed into order. And there are casualties. It's 10 to 4 and I'm still in the deli. Catherine is kneeling on the back seat of the Nissan, one foot sticking out of the open door, as she reaches down into the footwell below Ethan. The boy has dropped lugs again and is working up for a squall. His tiny ash-blonde eyebrows knitted in frustration. Oh, Ethan, be nice to Lugs. He doesn't like to be dropped on his head, Catherine says. She grasps the saliva-soggy rabbit when she hears shouting outside. She turns to see two men, one black, one white, both oozing menace. They are circling round a battered blue Vauxhall parked a few spaces back. Violent recriminations are hurled between them about the keys that each claims the other possesses. Catherine hears it, but what she doesn't know is that they've just committed a murder. They're second of the day, and they need to get out of there fast. But without keys, they can't. That's a lot of F's and C's, isn't it, Ethan? She whispers as she rests her face against the child and presses the now-retrieved lugs into the boy's tiny fingers. Suddenly frightened, she turns and pulls the rear door closed behind her and gives a satisfying clunk. Come on, Jeff, she thinks. Hurry up, I need you here. She wonders about the car keys dangling vulnerably in the Nissan steering column, a long reach away. The central locking button is closer, but would it work without the ignition on? There is a brief silence, the sound of running, two impacts, and suddenly there are two men in the front seats of her car. Hey, what do you think you're... She begins. The engine roars into life. The passenger, the black guy, turns dead eyes to her and pulls a gun from the inside of his puffer jacket. He points it right at her. Shut it, sister, he says. The car sets off like a racer and they are immediately screeching a U-turn in the side road beyond the deli. I am sprinting out of the shop towards her side of the vehicle, screaming at them to stop. Mesmerized, Catherine watches as I launch myself at the vehicle. She hears the impact and sees me splayed horizontally across the windscreen, hanging on to the wipers. I hear her screaming at them, "Stop, stop, stop!" She yells over the ululation of distress coming from Ethan. She knows for sure what is going to happen to me. She has seen the gun in Cousin's hand, though I have not. but then neither of us knew about the other weapon, the cruder, crueler, but equally deadly tool that is Fretwell's speciality. He had a name for what he does with it. Wet work. Chapter 3. The night before, Catherine had been lying awake. I sensed the shallowness of her breath, the sighing and the turning, which drew me out of a deeper sleep. I slid my arm around her, nestled into the warm curve of her, and whispered,
"What are you thinking about, love?"
She told me that she was wondering about where the spare office security key had gone. She'd been fretting about it since the weekend. Kelly Harris, her boss, had let her have it so she could come in on Sunday to finish up some online training. She had returned it to the key cupboard on Monday, but now it was missing. Kelly was blaming her. A lost key meant a £250 deposit forfeited to the property company. I knew the key wasn't really the issue. It was much bigger than that. She had been on edge about her job for months. Another round of restructuring was in train, initiated by a cut in funding by the local authority. 4 years earlier, she had already endured the ignominy of having to reapply for her own job. Actually not her own job, but what turned out to be a worse position with even less money. It just happened to include all her old responsibilities plus some new ones. No car allowance anymore, the separate training allowance and the 5 days a year she used to get to take extra training, that went too. She is still required to get the training, mandated is the word they used, it's mandatory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.